Simon & Schuster Audio presents Thrillville, USA Stories by Taylor Koekkoek. Read by Stephen Graybill, Lisa Larsen, and André Santana.
Thrillville, USA. In the first week of the last season at Thrillville, USA, a boy got all fucked up in the haunted mine. The animatronics tore a wasp nest apart somehow, and the kid came out stung to hell. Poor kid was riding alone, too. I'd always thought you could slip from the lap bar if you really wanted to, but I guess not. The minecart lurched out to the loading zone with this kid shrieking his head off, all pink and lumpy, a face pinpricked with bruised dots of blood. Denny and I didn't have any clue what to make of it at first. This deranged, swollen child shrieking like a cat set on fire? Then Glenn, with his prosthetic leg, came vaulting up on his forearm crutch, shouting for us to kill the ride and release the lap bar already. It took us a while to figure out what had happened. The kid didn't know those were wasps that attacked in the dark. He believed the haunted mine was really haunted, and with such conviction that I felt a bit skittish around the ride afterward. Glenn and I had to walk through the haunted mine with flashlights and find the shredded wasp nest buzzing to realize what had happened. I got stung on the hand. The kid was hospitalized, but he was okay. Glenn settled it out of court. He knew the kid's mother. They'd been sleeping together. She used to hang around, and he'd made a point of introducing her to everyone. She and Glenn strolled about, sometimes disappearing into his office trailer while the kid roamed the park off-leash. Glenn didn't move too well, and he carried some extra weight on him, but he was never without a girlfriend for the moment. We'd met a few of his short-stint lovers by then. He was a good guy, but we guessed it was the leg, the missing one. I mean, he looked bad, I told Jen. Really fucked. Probably he got stung in the eyes. How bad, though? She asked. Like, medical-wise. I don't know what you want from me, I told her. I was so hungover, the whole day felt like an anxiety hallucination. It looked like a pissed off witch doctor just went to town with a needle on like a voodoo doll version of the kid. Oh my god. Denny said if voodoo were real, he'd carry a little doll version of himself around and jerk it off and lick its ass all day. He knew the kinds of jokes I liked and told them, watching me from the corner of his eye. He was my very tallest friend. When he was drunk, he tossed me around like a little dog. It was great. Jen told Denny to grow up. The ambulance hadn't even left yet, she reminded us. That was the boy's mom in hysterics with the paramedics. Jen glowered at Denny with an expression that seemed to say, "You're just the worst, babe." The two of them were having a secret affair that everyone knew about. My least favorite part of the affair was that I had to play clueless about it, although Denny had clued me in from the start. Denny, right after their first night together, told me all. Too much. The noises she made, the color of her nipples. But Jen, he insisted, wasn't to know that I knew. So they fiddled with each other's genitals when they were at one side of the game counter and me at the other. I couldn't see the action, but I knew what was happening down there. Their mouths were half open and eyes half closed. Denny and Jen thought they were doing the most interesting thing in the world together. When they touched, they seemed amazed that something hadn't stopped them from touching. Nobody cared at all, but to them, it was magic. One time, Denny was on a bender and I was having trouble hunting him down, and I asked Jen where he was. It troubled her that I expected she'd know Denny's whereabouts. "I'm not his keeper," she said, indignant, as if I were the one who should be embarrassed, just for knowing the facts, just for being anyone other than the most ignorant person in the room. Denny was seeing a high schooler then, a girl named Katie. She was pretty and freckled, but she was too young, legally speaking. So they just kissed cheeks, he said, and sent each other dirty texts. sow the seed, he told me, and pluck the tomato a little sour, a little green, before anyone else takes it for their own caprese. Then he kissed his pinched fingertips with a big moi. He often used nonsense gardening metaphors to talk about Katie. Shucked corn and mushy peaches, etc. It was all geared toward the eventual eating of something. He was 25, and she was 16. One night, when Denny was super fucked, he told me they did hand stuff sometimes, but when he sobered up the next day, he said he was just joking. Maybe Jen was not quite as pretty as Katie, Denny theorized. But that might have been a virtue of Katie's leg up on her, youth-wise. I was a poor audience on this subject because I believed Jen and Katie, between the two of them, had more prettiness than Denny warranted. Jen's hair was so black that, right when I met her, I decided everyone I'd ever thought of as having black hair really had very dark brown hair. And she was mean, too. I loved that. Jen was technically married to a badass Mexican guy from Salem. He had a left shoulder full of cigarette burns, dozens of mottled ring-shaped scars overlaid like a gory octopus arm. He burned himself whenever he drank too much, even though no one had dared him to since middle school. He and Jen had a courthouse marriage in a spur-of-the-moment situation just before he shipped off on his first deployment. They didn't talk anymore, but they were man and wife in the legal sense and in the eyes of the Lord. What inconvenienced me, though, about the affair was that I'd had to move out of the one-bedroom apartment Denny and I shared. It made getting to work a hassle if I missed my ride with Glenn, since Denny and I'd gone in together on an old $200 Ford Pinto. We loved it. We drove it around like a go-kart. The rear bumper was torn up like a busted lip, and the front bumper just dropped off one night on its own. Technically, Denny and I shared custody, but mostly he kept it. I was reasonable about parting with the Pinto and apartment both. The apartment lease was in Denny's name, and it was his mom that helped with rent. It was her old raggedy sofa I slept on, too. Fair was fair. Denny'd told me his stepbrother was moving back to Turner and needed help getting on his feet. But then, his stepbrother never showed up, and Jen was always over, her clothes on the bedroom floor, beauty stuff all over the sink rim, strands of her long black hair in the drain. I put it together. Glenn let me crash on his couch. It wasn't like I was out on the street. He had a massive old tube TV and a bachelory place in the mobile home park at the next exit down I-5. The foot was the first thing I noticed about Glenn when we met a few years before. It didn't move right. I was only 21 then. I asked if his foot was fake during my interview. He said, "That's poor interview etiquette." Then he bent forward conspiratorially and hiked up the cuff of his jeans so I could get an eye on the metal prosthesis. He told me that in the 90s, he was hand-propping his ex-brother-in-law's Cessna, but when he yanked the motor running, the brake block beneath the tire must have jimmied loose because the airplane budged forward just a hair and the prop caught him right above the ankle. He said it flipped him a rotation and a half onto his head, and it shot his foot across the hangar bay with such force it dented the hangar wall. "The foot," he said solemnly, "exploded." He took painkillers for his phantom limb pains. Some days it felt like his foot was still there, he said, ghost toes wiggling on command, but it also felt like the foot was pinched in a vice. The pain flared up when he was stressed out or lonesome or feeling ashamed, which accounted for all his time on Earth. Denny and I figured he probably just had a pill problem like everyone else we knew, but we left him his story because, first off, we partied too. And secondly, because we liked Glenn, and also because Denny snuck us pills now and again from Glenn's stash. Glenn kept his pills in his office desk. He didn't like to keep his meds on him because he ended up relying on them too much, he said. I told him, sure, The desk was a fine stowing place. Glenn had owned Thrillville, USA for 4 years then, and each year of business was a miracle. The wasp incident was terrible timing. It came on the heels of another bad one. The previous season, a heavy drunk managed to launch himself from the magic carpet.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.